Before we get started, I'd like to go to the Lord in prayer. So if you could kneel with me, I would appreciate it. Our dear Father in heaven, we come to you this morning and we thank you so much for all that you have done for us, Lord. We thank you for the wonderful opportunity to open up your word and come to you for guidance and instruction. And we thank you for the gift of your Son and the gift of his Spirit in our hearts to guide and direct us and make intercession for us. Lord, I ask that you would pour out your Spirit upon each one of us and open our eyes that we may behold wonderful things out of your law. And I pray that the things we learn would be helpful in our daily lives, that we can be more like you. And so please guide me as the word spoken, that they would not be of me, but of you. And we thank you and praise you now. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. All right, today we're going to be looking at the prophecies of Daniel 11. So, Daniel, there's only 12 chapters in Daniel, so this, looking at this presupposes that you've already looked at Daniel
2.
Yes, definitely 2, 7, 8, and 9. They all go together. So, this is just a cap on that. So, if you haven't looked at those, go study those first. So, we're looking at prophecies of Daniel 11, and I want to start out in 1 Corinthians 13, verse 1, here it says, though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels, and have not charity, which is actually love, I am become a sounding brass or a tinkling cymbal. And though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, what did it say? Though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I could remove mountains and have not charity, I am nothing. And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned and have not charity, it profits me nothing. So I want you to understand that as we're looking at this topic, if you don't have love in your heart, it's not going to do you any good. All right, let's go to John 13:35. Unfortunately, I have a lot of material, so I'm going to go somewhat rapidly. John 13:35, it says, by this shall all men know that you are my disciples if you have love one to another. Notice that the identifying mark of God's people is the love that they have for one another.
Amen.
And it's not, the identifying mark is not what they believe about prophecy or what they believe about certain things. The identifying mark is the love that they have for one another. So I want you to understand that all of the things that we know, all the knowledge that we gain is for, to get us to that one point where we love people as we love ourselves. Love one another, love God with all your heart, love your neighbor as yourself. That is the identifying characteristic of God's people.
Too.
Yeah, and love our enemies. I'm glad you brought that up.
Hard part.
Yeah, when people are mean to us, to love them as well. Now, how does that love come? 1 John 4:7 tells us, beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God. So where does it, who's the source?
God
is the source of that love. So you can't just think and meditate and try to start loving the person that you don't like right now. That's not going to work. The only way you can love that person or those people or whoever is if you have Christ in your heart. Because love comes from God and Christ is our access to God.
Yes.
Amen.
Love is of God. Everyone that loveth is born of God and knoweth God. So, friends, keep that in mind. All of this information that we're looking at today will do you no good if you don't have the love of God in your heart. So let's get that established, get that strong. And so that you love even your enemies and, of course, your friends. James 2:19, thou believest that there is one God, thou doest well. Good job. But before you start patting yourself on the back, the devils also believe and tremble. Wilt thou know, O vain man, that faith without works is dead? So what often happens, if we trust in our beliefs, if our in our doctrines, see, this is the way the Jews were. They trusted in their doctrines.
Mm-hmm.
They became very Pharisaical. Pharisaical, right? They thought that being a Pharisee was the most godly type of person you can be. But Jesus said, except your righteousness exceed the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees, you shall not enter the kingdom of God. So, friends, that's what I encourage you, each of you, if you do not have the love of God in your heart, it doesn't matter how many doctrines you know or how good a prophecy you know, and if you know all things, you're able to speak with tongues of men and of angels. If you don't have the love of God in your heart, it's wasting time. And in fact, it tends to turn you into worse than you were before.
Yes.
Let me explain. Because if as you build up all this knowledge, it tends to puff you up. That's what the Bible says. And then you start looking down at other people. So that's a very dangerous thing. And so that's what I encourage you guys, because I see you guys all at a high level in your knowledge and understanding. But at that place, you're in more danger of being critical and unkind to people around you. So anyway, that's what I'm encouraging you guys to really get that settled, get that straight, because you guys are in more need of it than anyone, if you understand what I'm saying.
Yes.
John 5, 39 and 40, Jesus said, "Search the scriptures, for in them ye think ye have eternal life. And they are they which testify of me, and ye will not come to me that ye may have life." That's a sad thing, isn't it? If we're just searching the scriptures thinking that in them we have eternal life, when we're just ignoring the whole thing that matters, which is Jesus Christ in your heart, which will be demonstrated in the way you treat people. If that's not happening, if you're not demonstrating the love of God in your heart, then all of this knowledge is useless. So please, please make sure you get that straight, because we're very much in danger of that. All right. John 8:32, Jesus, and 34 and 36, we're going to read, "And you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free." What are we free from?
Sin.
"Whosoever committeth sin," Jesus said, "is a servant of sin." Right in the context, he tells you what you're free of. Free of sin. So friends, that's another thing I'm encouraging you guys. Whatever your condition is, whatever's going on, examine yourselves to see whether you be in the faith. Examine yourselves. Are you living in sin? Are you regarding iniquity in your heart? Because that all of this other stuff doesn't matter if that's what's happening. So let's, friends, we're nearing the end of time.
Yes.
It's time to not be fake.
Yes.
Amen.
Be real. Be genuine. When you're alone with God, that's where it really counts, not to be seen of men. Anyway, he says, "Whosoever committeth sin is a servant of sin. If the Son, therefore, shall make you free, ye shall be free indeed." So who makes you free?
Son.
Knowing the truth is knowing the Son, really, because he says, "I am the way, the truth, and the life." So knowing him is really what makes you free. So all the doctrines that we know is to get us to that point. If it's not doing that, it's doing us no good. All right, now much of what I'm going to be looking at today, it comes from a book called Daniel and Revelation. I mean, that's what we're gonna be reading, Daniel 11, but I would encourage you to read this book. This is a good basis to start with. A lot of the beginning of it is actually very much in harmony with a lot of commentators on Daniel 11. So we're going to start in verse 2, Daniel 11, verses 2 and 3. It says, "And now will I show thee the truth. Behold, there shall stand up yet three kings in Persia, and the fourth shall be far richer than they all, and by his strength, through his riches, he shall stir up all against the realm of Grecia. And a mighty king shall stand up that shall rule with great dominion and do according to his will." There's a mighty king going to stand up. "When he shall stand up, his kingdom," we're in verse 4 now, "when he shall stand up, his kingdom shall be broken and shall be divided toward the four winds of heaven, and not to his posterity, nor according to his dominion which he ruled, for his kingdom shall be plucked up even for others beside those." Does that sound familiar to anything else in Daniel?
Yes.
Daniel chapter 8, verse 8, there's the vision of the ram and the goat. And in verse 8 it says, "Therefore the he-goat waxed very great, and when he was strong, the great horn was broken, and for it came up four notable ones toward the four winds of heaven." That phrase, the four winds of heaven, is the same as we just read here. And then in verses 21 and 22, the angel Gabriel explains this. He says, "And the rough goat is the king of Grecia, and the great horn that is between his eyes is the first king." Anybody know who that king is?
Alexander
the Great. That's right. "Now that being broken, whereas four stood up for it, four kingdoms shall stand up out of that nation, but not in his power." There were four four generals that took over that kingdom, and none of them were the posterity of Alexander the Great. Alexander the Great was a great king, and he died in his strength while he was relatively young. Alexander the Great was the first king, and then after that, there were four of his most ambitious generals. They exterminated all of Alexander's posterity. And we just read that it would not be according to us posterity. And then these four generals were Cassander. He was in the west with Greece and the adjacent countries. Then Lysimachus to the north, he had Thrace. And to the east was Seleucus. He had Syria and Babylon. And to the south was Ptolemy. He had Egypt. Here's a map of those regions, general map, as you can see from there's the north, east, west, and south. But what happened very soon after that, let's go ahead and read verse 5. It says, "The king of the south shall be strong, and one of his princes, and he shall be strong above him and have dominion. His dominion shall be a great dominion." Here is a picture. So I'm describing it, what's going on. When Alexander the Great died, his kingdom was split into those four regions, but then very soon it became two regions because the Seleucus, who was in the east, he took over Cassander and Lysimachus, which made him the king of the north. Seleucus won. And then the king of the south was Egypt. Now, in verse 6, it says, "In the end of the years, these shall join themselves together, for the king's daughter of the south shall come to the king of the north to make an agreement. But she shall not retain the power of the arm, neither shall he stand, nor his arm, but she shall be given up, and they that brought her, and he that begat her, and he that strengthened her in these times." Verses 7 and 8, "But out of a branch of her roots shall one stand up in his estate, which shall come with an army and shall enter into the fortress of the king of the north and shall deal against them and shall prevail and shall also carry captives into Egypt their gods with their princes and with their precious vessels of silver and of gold, and he shall continue more years than the king of the north." Verses 9 and 10, "So the king of the south shall come into his kingdom and shall return into his own land, but his sons shall be stirred up and shall assemble a multitude of great forces, and one shall certainly come and overflow and pass through. Then shall he return and be stirred up even to his fortress." I'm not commenting on this much right now, so just bear with me. "And the king of the south shall be moved with choler and shall come forth and fight with him, even with the king of the north, and he shall set forth a great multitude, but the multitude shall be given into his hand, and when he hath taken away the multitude, his heart shall be lifted up, and he shall cast down many, 10,000s, but he shall not be strengthened by it." Verse 13, "For the king of the north shall return and shall set forth a multitude greater than the former and shall certainly come after certain years with a great army and with much, much riches." Now, one thing that's really striking about these verses is the clarity and the depth of the description of this. If you look at Daniel 2, you have a very broad description of the kingdoms that were going to arise after Babylon. In Daniel 7, it gets more detailed. Daniel 8, it gets even more detailed, names them by name, Greece and Medo-Persia. And then now we get to Daniel 11, and you get much more detail. What's really striking about this is the timing when it was written. When was it written? It was written by Daniel around 600 BC, approximately. And he is talking about things that were going to happen in the future in great detail. Mm-hmm. These aren't things that he could just know by himself. God had to reveal this to him. This is as far as I know, this is the most descriptive identification of future events in the whole Bible. I could be wrong, but in one place you have the most detailed description of future events given in the Bible. And they all came to pass, just like they were said. Many years later, this prophecy brings us all the way up to the second coming of Christ, when you get to Daniel 12 combined with it. So I find this really amazing because God showed us plainly the validity of his word and the truth of who he is. because no mere man could come up with this stuff. Here's a picture of some of the things that this was talking about, what we just read, Daniel 11, 6 through 13. All of these kings, you got Antiochus 1, Theos, Antiochus 2, Theos, they had weird names back then. Seleucus 2, Seleucus 3, Antiochus Magnus the Great. Anyway, I'm just displaying this for your benefit for the future. I've got so much material to cover, so now that you have them, they should be online in the video. You can pause it, check these things out for yourself. But also, I encourage you to read that book, Daniel and Revelation, because it goes through in detail all of these things and explains it. So I'm not going to get up here and just read you a book, but I will tell you, please read the book. It's quite valuable. Verse 14, in those times there shall many stand up against the king of the south. Also the robbers of thy people shall exalt themselves to establish the vision, but they shall fall. Verses 15 and 16, so the king of the north shall come and cast up a mount and take the most fenced cities, and the arms of the south shall not withstand, neither his chosen people, neither shall there be any strength to withstand. But he that cometh against him shall do according to his own will, and none shall stand before him, and he shall stand in the glorious land, which by his hand shall be consumed. He shall also set his face to enter with the strength of his whole kingdom, and upright ones with him. Thus shall he do, and he shall give him the daughter of women, corrupting her, but she shall not stand on his side, neither before him. You know who that daughter of women is talking about? Have you ever heard of Cleopatra? Cleopatra is an Egyptian ruler. Actually, she was a ruler in Egypt. And that is who this is talking about. Now, the details of that, again, I encourage you to read that book, Daniel and Revelation. It will explain this in detail. Also, just about any Bible commentary will tell you the same thing. So far, what we read, almost all Bible commentaries are in agreement up to this point. Now, there becomes very soon a split or divergence from that. But this is Cleopatra that it's talking about. And Cleopatra, she lived not very long before Christ. Ptolemy and Cleopatra, at a young age, Ptolemy and Cleopatra inherited the kingdom of Egypt in 51 BC. So that's not far behind when Jesus was here. The Roman general Pompey was appointed the guardian of the young siblings. Now that was a little bit interesting situation because the Romans were given control of Egypt at that point. But still, they hadn't overtaken everything yet. But that's who that was, is Cleopatra. Now verses 18 and 19, it says, after this shall he turn his face unto the isles and shall take many. But a prince for his own behalf shall cause the reproach offered by him to cease. Without his own reproach, he shall cause it to turn upon him. Then he shall turn his face toward the fort of his own land, but he shall stumble and fall and not be found. Here is another illustration of what we just read, some of the wars. What Daniel 11 is doing is it's describing how kingdoms rose and fell and how these battles were taking place. And it's in great detail. It's really stunning to read an explanation of that, like Daniel and Revelation, just to see how detailed the Bible actually is. It didn't mention people by name here, but it mentions very detailed events in their lives. And now we're going to read Daniel 11, verse 20. It says, then shall stand up in his estate a raiser of taxes in the glory of the kingdom, but within few days he shall be destroyed, neither in anger nor in battle. Now here it talks about somebody who is a raiser of taxes. Look at this statement. This is from the St. Louis Globe Democrat of July 1895, as quoted in Daniel and Revelation, page 266. It says, Augustus Caesar was the most exacting tax collector the Roman world had up to that time ever seen. Augustus Caesar was a tax collector. And in fact, in Luke chapter 2, verse 1, what does it say? And it came to pass in those days that there went out a decree from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be taxed. Now you remember the story of that. This is when Jesus' parents, Mary and Joseph, took that trip to Nazareth. Bethlehem. Forgive me. They from Nazareth to Bethlehem so that they could be taxed. This was the purpose of it. And it was Augustus Caesar, and he was prophesied in Daniel 11 600 years earlier. That's pretty amazing, the detail of this. He was going to be a raiser of taxes, and that's exactly what happened here. The timing is perfect. Augustus Caesar, also his death, if you look what it says in verse 20, then shall he stand up in his estate, a raiser of taxes in the glory of the kingdom, but within few days he shall be destroyed, neither in anger nor in battle. So it says that Augustus Caesar was going to not die in battle, which happened a lot in these kingdoms, all these battles that were going on, but this particular person was not going to die in battle. And look what happened in the way he died. Augustus died not in anger nor in battle, but peacefully in his bed at Nola, whither he had gone to seek repose and health in AD 14. In the 76th year of his age. That's from Daniel and Revelation, page 266. So anyway, I'm just amazed by reading this history that was written down before it happened. It just goes to show how amazing God is.
And you can compare it with actual history.
That's what Daniel and Revelation does. The book Daniel and Revelation, it compares it with history. Plus, so do many Bible commentaries. They will explain these things, just comparing them with history. But I recommend that book to read that as a good place to understand these things. Daniel 11:21, it says, in his estate shall stand up a vile person to whom they shall not give the honor of the kingdom, but he shall come in peaceably and obtain the kingdom by flatteries. Again, very detailed instructions here, or description. And Tiberius Caesar was the next who appeared after Augustus Caesar on the Roman throne. Again, that's from Daniel and Revelation, page 266. So here you get more. Now, there's another view of this. This comes from Adam Clark's commentary, and if you read Daniel and Revelation, he actually quotes from Clark's commentary quite a bit. But here, Clark diverges. His statement says this was Antiochus, surnamed Epiphanes. Now, Antiochus Epiphanes, if you're familiar with Daniel 8, and the prophecy there, there are a lot of people who claim that Antiochus Epiphanes was this little horn. But there's severe problems with that. As you look at the prophecy, they went from great to very great to exceeding great. And Antiochus Epiphanes was not exceeding great. He was less great than Alexander the Great, if you just look at the story of his life. And plus, the timing is all off. Anyway, so this idea that it's Antiochus Epiphanes does not work at all. And I'm not studying Daniel 8 right now, or I would explain all of that in more detail. Verse 22, it says, and with the arms of a flood shall they be overflown from before him, and shall be broken. Yea, also the prince of the covenant, and after the league made with him, he shall work deceitfully, for he shall come up and shall become strong with a small people. That is actually referring to Rome, the rise of Rome. When it started, it was a very small people. It's pretty interesting the way Rome grew, but it became strong very quickly. That's why in the Bible it's referred to as the iron, you know, the legs of iron in Daniel 2. Daniel 7, it's that fourth beast that is diverse from all the rest. Verse 24, and he shall enter peaceably even upon the fattest places of the province, and he shall do that which his fathers have not done, nor his fathers' fathers. He shall scatter among them the prey and spoil and riches, yea, and he shall forecast his devices against the strongholds, even for a time. A time is 360 days, which in prophecy is 360 years, which you can read about that also in Daniel and Revelation. And Daniel verse 25, it says, and he shall stir up his power and his courage against the king of the south with a great army, and the king of the south shall be stirred up to battle with a very great and mighty army, but he shall not stand, for they shall forecast devices against him. Verse 26, yea, they that feed of the portion of his meat shall destroy him, and his army shall overflow, and many shall fall down slain, and both these kings' hearts shall be to do mischief, and they shall speak lies at one table, but it shall not prosper, for yet the end shall be at the time appointed. Here is another graph showing some of the wars that went on. If you notice here during this time period, is when Jesus Christ arose on the scene and died. Remember, Rome was in power when Christ was here. They were the ones, the Roman soldiers, who actually nailed the nails into his hands and put him on the cross. Also in this time period was the destruction of Jerusalem. Jerusalem was destroyed in 70 AD, surrounded again by who? Rome. Rome, and Jesus foretold this in Matthew 24 when he said that there's not going to be one stone left upon another. And that's exactly what happened. Every stone was taken down out of the temple. All right, Daniel 11, 28 and 29, it says, "Then shall he return into his land with great riches, and his heart shall be against the holy covenant, and he shall do exploits." Now that's a weird word, exploits. It means great things, something amazing. "And he shall do exploits and return to his own land. At the time appointed, he shall return and come toward the south. But it shall not be as the former or as the latter." Here again is a description of, or a graph to show the time period of what was going on through this prophecy. And again, this is all based on the book Daniel and Revelation, which goes through this. If you guys need my notes, I'll give them to you. So, but all of this will be in the notes. Now let's continue on. Daniel 11, verse 30. "For the ships of Chittim shall come against him. Therefore he shall be grieved and return and have indignation against the holy covenant. So shall he do. He shall even return and have intelligence with them that forsake the holy covenant. An arm shall stand on his part, and they shall pollute the sanctuary of strength, and shall take away the daily," it says sacrifice, but of course that's added in, "and they shall place the abomination that makes desolate, and such as do wickedly against the covenant shall be he corrupt by flatteries, but the people that do know their God shall be strong and do exploits." That's a very significant verse, because the people that know their God are going to be strong. You know what we started off with is the importance of having the love of God in your heart, which comes by knowing his love for you. He is of God. We love him because he first loved us. And so knowing God is going to make you strong. What's the opposite? Not knowing God and being weak. And so that just verifies what we started off with, that how important it is that you have love. Though you speak the, understand all the prophecies and you can speak with tongues of angels, even if you give your body to be burned, give all your possessions to the poor, if you don't have love, it's not going to do you any good. And it's actually very likely going to make you worse off. So, anyway, let's go on. Verses 33 to 35, it says, "And they that understand among the people shall instruct many. Yet they shall fall by the sword, and by flame, by captivity, and by spoil, many days. Now when they shall fall, they shall be holpen with a little help. But many shall cleave to them with flatteries, and some of them of understanding shall fall, to try them, and to purge, and to make them white, even to the time of the end, because it is yet for a time appointed." You know, there's a lot of hardships that are going to come on this world. Jesus foretold a time of trouble such as not been since the world began, nor ever to that same time. So we need to be ready. That's one reason it says right before that, they're going to be strong if you know God. If you don't know God, you're not going to be strong. So that's an extremely important aspect of this whole prophecy, is knowing God, which we'll look at in more detail shortly. Here's another chart explaining the details of Daniel 11, 30-35. A significant part of that is that it covers the time prophecy of 538 to 1798, which is the 1260 years of papal supremacy. All right, let's go on now to Daniel 11, verse 36. Daniel 11, 36, it says, "And the king shall do according to his will, and shall exalt himself and magnify himself above every god, and shall speak marvelous things against the God of gods, and shall prosper till the indignation be accomplished, for that is determined shall be done. Verses 37 and 38, neither shall he regard the God of his fathers, nor the desire of women, nor regard any god. For he shall magnify himself above all, but in his estate shall he honor the God of forces, and a God whom his fathers knew not shall he honor with gold and silver and with precious stones and pleasant things. Thus shall he do in the most strongholds with a strange god, whom he shall acknowledge and increase with glory, and he shall cause them to rule over many, and shall divide the land for gain. Now, here is a description, also taken from Daniel and Revelation, of this time period that covers the French Revolution. If you're familiar with the French Revolution, Daniel and Revelation goes into detail. Now, there are some things in that, that the atheistic France, they had a strange god of reason, and that was strange that they instituted this goddess of reason. They even made a little image of it and had people honor it. And it also discredited marriage. The marriage covenant was thrown out by France. You see that today, don't you? Mm-hmm. Marriage is under attack again. Big attack. Anyway, there was an attack in atheistic France on marriage as well. And then here's a quote from Daniel in Revelation, page 294. This government, at the same time it declared that God did not exist, would trample underfoot the law which God had given to regulate the marriage institution. There's much more details in that in the book Daniel in Revelation, so you can check that out for yourself. Let's go on to Daniel 11, verse 40. It says, at that time of the end shall the king of the south push at him, and the king of the north shall come against him like a whirlwind, with chariots and with horsemen and with many ships. And he shall enter into the countries and shall overflow and pass over. He shall enter also, verses 41 and 42, he shall enter also into the glorious land, and many countries shall be overthrown. But these shall escape out of his hand, even Edom and Moab, and the chief of the children of Ammon. He shall stretch forth his hand also upon the countries, and the land of Egypt shall not escape. That's really interesting, too. He mentions by name Edom, Moab, and Ammon, that they're going to escape. I'm just amazed by the detail of all of this. Look at 43 and 44. But he shall have power over the treasures of gold and of silver, and over all the precious things of Egypt. And the Libyans and the Ethiopians shall be at his steps, but tidings out of the east and out of the north shall trouble him. Therefore he shall go forth with great fury to destroy and utterly to make away many. Verse 45, and he shall plant the tabernacles of his palace between the seas in the glorious holy mountain, yet he shall come to his end, and none shall help him. That's actually the last verse of Daniel 11. And when it says he shall plant his tabernacle of his palace between the seas and the glorious holy mountain, what do you think that's talking about?
Jerusalem.
That's the glorious holy mountain that it's talking about there, is Jerusalem. That's where he's going to plant the tabernacle of his palace. Now, here is a description, diagram of what's going on here in this chapter, at the end of these verses here. The king of the north would be the Turkey in these texts. Look at this. Newton on the Prophecies says, between the seas in the glorious holy mountain must denote, as we have shown, some part of the Holy Land. There the Turk shall encamp with all his powers, yet he shall come to his end, and none shall help him. Shall help him effectually or deliver him. That's Newton on the Prophecies, page 318, as quoted in Daniel and Revelation, page 318. Anyway, this, I want you guys to pay close attention to Turkey. I don't know if you've noticed recently, if you paid much attention to the news, but Turkey is in the news quite a bit lately. If you look at a map of where Turkey is, I don't have that map right here, but Turkey is situated in a very key place. So That's actually where the headquarters of Rome was set up, at Constantinople. That's Istanbul today. So I just encourage you guys to really pay attention to Turkey and Jerusalem as well, because that's where the prophecy ends. Now, again, I encourage you to read this book, Daniel and Revelation. And I want to show, here's something about Turkey in the news that's just recently. This was in May of this year, 2018. From Istanbul, Turkey, which is the capital of Turkey, which used to be Constantinople, the capital of Rome, is where Constantine moved his capital. That's why it's called Constantinople. But it's now called Istanbul. Turkish President Recep Tayyip Erdogan, I don't know if I said that right, has called on Muslim leaders to unite and confront Israel. Days after scores of Palestinians were killed by Israeli snipers as they marked 70 years of Israeli occupation. Earlier in the day, Erdogan told a raucous crowd of more than 10,000 people in Istanbul's Yenikapi fairground that the Muslim world had to unite and pull themselves back together. Muslims are way too busy fighting and disagreeing with themselves. You ever notice anything like that going on? It's not only in the Muslim world, is it? Anyway, he says, Muslims are way too busy fighting and disagreeing with themselves and shy away when confronted by their enemies, he told the audience. Since 1947, Israel has been free to do what it likes in this region. They do whatever they feel like. But this reality can be undone if we unite. Anyway, that was just printed in Al Jazeera News. The article is called Erdogan Calls on Muslim Countries to Unite and Confront Israel. That was in Al Jazeera News of May 18, 2018. So that was just last month. There is this call from the Turkish government to unite Muslims to fight against Israel. Anyway, and that would be a fulfillment of verse 45 of Daniel 11, what we just read. He's going to plant his kingdom in the glorious land between these two seas, which is Jerusalem. So anyway, continue to pay close attention to that, because it's going to come up again in the news. Matthew 24, verse 3. Jesus said, as he sat upon the Mount of Olives, the disciples came unto him privately, saying, now this is right after Jesus said that the temple is going to be cast down, every stone is going to be pulled down. And so the disciples came to him and said, tell us, when shall these things be, and what shall be the sign of thy coming and of the end of the world? Now do you notice here, this is a twofold question. This is a question of when is Jerusalem going to be destroyed, when is the temple going to be overthrown, and what is going to be the signs of the end of the world and of thy coming. So now Jesus' answer, or part of his answer, says, when ye therefore shall see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet. Did we just read about the abomination of desolation in Daniel the prophet? Yeah. It's more. It's not only right there. You know, check it out. It's also in Daniel 8. And Daniel 12. When ye therefore shall see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet, now it says something, stand in the holy place. Whoso readeth, let him understand. This indicates that the spiritual things are spiritually discerned, right? You can't just understand this on your own. Let them which be in Judea flee into the mountains. Let him which is on the housetop not come down to take anything out of his house, neither let him which is in the field return back to take his clothes. That indicates a very sudden, rapid fleeing from persecution. Was this fulfilled at the fall of Jerusalem in 70 AD? Do you remember what happened?
The Roman,
help me with the name, Cestus, came and planted his banner outside of Jerusalem, basically claiming it as his own. But he didn't overthrow it. at that time. He got called out. He went back. I think it was 2 years, right?
Three years.
Well, anyway, what's that? So, but he did come back.
Titus came back.
And he overthrew. Was it 4 years? Okay. Thank you. Well, we're getting close. Regardless, it was in 70 AD that they finally got destroyed. And that was a very brutal battle. Really, what they did is they cut them off from food and water. And so they... Yeah, it was a siege. So it was really bad. But they had time to get out, didn't they?
That's right.
Yes.
They had time. When the Roman soldiers first came and planted that flag, they had time. That was their sign to get out.
Yes.
And the description here is to get out quickly. Don't even go down to your house to get anything out of your house. Run. Get out. Now, remember, this is a twofold prophecy. This was not just for their time. Whose time is it for also? It's for our time, right? It says the end of the age, the time of Jesus is coming. So we need to study the books of the book of Daniel and understand what the abomination of desolation is, and especially what it means when it stands in the holy place. What does that mean? Because that's going to be the sign to get out. And one thing that we just read in Daniel 12, or Daniel 11, the very last verse, and keep in mind the very next verse is Daniel 12, verse 1. And what does it say? At that time, Michael shall stand up, the great prince that stands for thy people. And then there's going to be a time of trouble such as never was. So that's that sign in Daniel 11, 35 is the last thing before Michael stands up. So it's very critical for us to examine what's going on there. So again, I encourage you to read the book Daniel and Revelation. But I also want to open your minds to there's more. Okay? Look at this is a statement, a very pertinent E.G. White statement. It says, "We have no time to lose. Troublous times are before us." Is that true?
Yes.
"The world is stirred with a spirit of war." See that? It's very big right now. "Soon the scenes of trouble spoken of in the prophecies will take place. The prophecy in the 11th of Daniel," what chapter?
The 11th.
"The prophecies in the 11th of Daniel," we just read the whole thing.
Yes.
All the way through. "But the prophecies in the 11th of Daniel has nearly reached its complete fulfillment." You know, we haven't reached the end of Daniel 11 yet. We're right at the end, though.
Otherwise, Michael would have stood up.
Right. Otherwise, Michael would have already stood up. We're right at the end. But check this out. It says, "The prophecy in the 11th of Daniel has nearly reached its complete fulfillment. Much of the history that has taken place in fulfillment of this prophecy will be repeated." Did you know that?
Yes.
"Much of the history of the fulfillment of this prophecy in Daniel 11 will be repeated." So... We've just looked at, and I gave you the slides to check it out in more detail and the encouragement to read Daniel and Revelation to get more detail of the history. But guess what? Much of that history is going to be repeated. So there is a fulfillment of that that's described and outlined in the book Daniel and Revelation, but there is a repeating of those prophecies as well. Much of the prophecies of Daniel 11 are going to be repeated. So don't rest with whatever understanding you may have right now of Daniel 11. There's more, right? Because much of that is going to be repeated. In the 30th verse, a power is spoken of. She even explains specifically parts of Daniel 11 that are going to be repeated. In the 30th verse, a power is spoken of that shall be grieved and return and have indignation against the Holy Covenant. And remember, this was in verse 30, we're going to read the rest of it. "So shall he do, he shall even return and have intelligence." Sorry about this slide, doesn't quite reach the end. "So shall he do, he shall even return and have intelligence with them that forsake the Holy Covenant, and arms shall stand on his part, and they shall pollute the sanctuary of strength, and shall take away the daily sacrifice." It's italicized. It's not there. The daily. And they shall place the abomination that maketh desolate, and such as do wickedly against the covenant shall he corrupt by flatteries. But the people that do know their God shall be strong and do?
Exploits.
Exploits. You guys already know the other word there. The people that do know their God are going to be strong and do exploits. So this is still from the statement that Ellen White is reading this and says that these prophecies are going to be repeated. And they that understand, this is still part of the quote, and they that understand among the people shall instruct many, yet they shall fall by the sword and by flame, by captivity and by spoil many days. Now when they shall fall, they shall be holpen with a little help, but many shall cleave to them with flatteries. And some of them of understanding shall fall, to try them, and to purge, and to make them white, even to the time of the end, because it is yet for a time appointed. You know when it says purge and make them white, what is that talking about? Remember what the white robes are? The righteousness of Christ, right? So it's purifying their characters. And the king shall do according to his will. What verse is this? Verse 36. This is still quoting, Ellen White is quoting this. And the king shall do according to his will, and he shall exalt himself and magnify himself above every god, and shall speak marvelous things against the God of gods, and shall prosper till the indignation be accomplished, for that is determined shall be done. Scenes similar to those described in these words will take place. So she says that has a future application. So we've looked at a historic application, but there's also a future application of this verse. And much of Daniel 11. Scenes similar to those described in these words will take place. We see evidence that Satan is fast obtaining the control of human minds who have not the fear of God before them. Let all read and understand the prophecies of this book, for we are now entering upon the time of trouble spoken of. And then Daniel 12, 1 through 4 is quoted, which is the next part. That came from letter number 103, February 24th, 1904. It's also found in Manuscript Releases, volume 13, pages 393 and 394, and it's manuscript 1077. And I'll give you all of this information. You can get it online because it's being recorded, I believe. And this part will be on the video, maybe?
As long as I have the... Okay. Actually, I have to have you fix it for me.
All right.
Is this the second manuscript, 1077? Is that page number? What is it?
There's no page number. That's just the manuscript 1077.
Okay.
It was part of the manuscript release, the unpublished... Well, prior to that, letter 103 was released in 2015.
Okay.
And so I quoted actually from that letter. It's also found in manuscript releases, but it's not...
have that little extra phrase in it.
This one has the actual verses quoted, Daniel 11, 30 to 36, which is what we just read. Anyway, so I just wanted you to understand, don't rest complete and satisfied on your lees, so to speak, with your understanding of Daniel 11 if it's only based on what we just read in Daniel, in the book Daniel and Revelation, or from the commentaries from Daniel and Revelation, because there's more to it. Ellen White says it will be repeated. That prophecy specifically, and it's pertinent to understand verses 36 to 39, which look at 2 Thessalonians 2, 3 through 5. It says, "Let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come, except there come a falling away first, and that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition." Who's the man of sin? Anybody know? The Pope. The papacy. Keep in mind that a lot of what we're looking at is based upon the fact that you already studied Daniel 2, 7, 8, and 9. So that's why we're in Daniel 11 now. This man of sin, yes, it is the papacy. You'll find that many places. Almost all Protestant Bible commentaries will make that claim as well, that this is referring to the papacy. Anyway, but look what it says. There's going to be a falling away. The man of sin is going to be revealed. The son of perdition, who opposes and exalts himself above all that is called God or that is worshipped, so that he as God sits in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. Now look at this verse. Remember ye not that when I was yet with you, I told you these things? That's important. When Paul was with, this is written to Thessalonians, when Paul was with them, he showed them, I told you these things. I told you about it. So this letter is based upon a study that he already had with them in person. Now look what he, look what the Bible says, that what happened when he was with them in person, Acts 17, 1 and 2. Now when they had passed through Amphipolis and Apollonia, they came to Thessalonica, where was a synagogue of the Jews. And Paul, as his manner was, went in unto them, and three Sabbath days reasoned with them out of the Scriptures. What Scriptures did he reason with them out of? It was the Old Testament. That was all that was available. But he says, when I was with you, I told you these things. And he showed them from the Scriptures. What Scripture in the Old Testament is this referring to? Daniel. Specifically, what part of Daniel? This is almost word for word from Daniel 11:36. Almost word for word. And that's, honestly, this fits the scenario more than anything else that I've seen of what Paul was reasoning with them from when he was with the Thessalonians. And he said, so this was based on, his statement here is based upon what he studied with them out of the Scriptures. And I believe that more than any other scripture, he was quoting Daniel 11:36-39. 36 specifically, but let's look at that. Daniel 11:36, and the king shall do according to his will. So now we're back in Daniel, even though it will sound like it's what we just read, because it is almost. And the king shall do according to his will, and he shall exalt himself and magnify himself. Isn't that what we just read? He exalts himself above all that is called God. And then it says, he shall magnify himself above every god, and shall speak marvelous things against the God of gods, and shall prosper till the indignation be accomplished, for that is determined shall be done. Now, as we already noticed, the man of sin in 2 Thessalonians is referring to the papacy, the papal power. So when we're here in Daniel 11:36, and we were already told that this prophecy is going to be repeated, right? So I seriously believe we also need to look at the papacy in fulfillment of this prophecy as well, especially in our day, right? So not only look at Turkey and Jerusalem and how that relation is going on in the news, also look at the papacy and Jerusalem and how that's going on in the news. See what I'm saying? Because watch, you'll see some amazing things here in just a minute. Daniel 11:37-38, it says, neither shall he regard the God of his fathers, nor the desire of women. Now, again, that prophecy can also be applied to the papacy, for they banned marriage of the priests, the celibacy of the priesthood, and the pope. He can't be married. So, neither shall he regard the God of his fathers. Is that something that the papacy has done also? When the papacy came to power, it really came to power on the strength of the Trinity doctrine. And it was because of the Trinity doctrine that they uprooted the three horns. Do you remember that story? If you guys already studied Daniel 7, that little horn that comes up uproots three horns. And those horns, the reason they were uprooted was because they were Arian powers, right? That's how he came to power. That's actually what 538, the reason that date came about is because when he overcame the Goths. So neither shall he regard the God of his fathers, nor the desire of women, nor regard any god, for he shall magnify himself above all. But in his estate shall he honor the God of forces, and a god whom his fathers knew not shall he honor with the gold and silver and with precious stones and pleasant things. Have you ever been in a Catholic church? Is there any gold and silver and precious things? It's decked out, right? I was in India, and all of their, they have shrines all over the place, that the pagans out worshiping Hindu gods. But I went into a Catholic church there, and they're decked out in there too. But anyway, this prophecy can also apply to them. God, whom his fathers knew not, shall he honor with gold and silver and with precious stones and pleasant things. Thus shall he do in the most strongholds with a strange God, whom he shall acknowledge and increase with glory, and he shall cause them to rule over many and shall divide the land for gain. Here it mentions a strange God. I think this very aptly applies to the God of the papacy. If you ever seen a picture of a three-headed Trinity, where they try to depict the Trinity and they put three faces on one head, one body, that is very strange. It's foreign to what we read in the Bible, but it is the God of the papacy. And I believe, people have asked me, is the Trinity in the Bible? Is the Trinity in the Bible? You know, some would say, no, it's not. Well, actually, I say, yes, it is in the Bible. It's mentioned specifically right here. It's called a strange God. It's not spoken of positively. Okay, William Miller, you know who that was?
Yes.
William Miller, in the year 1833, so this is a long time ago, he wrote, first he quoted Daniel 11:36, and then he said, the king spoken of in this verse is the little horn, in allusion to the papal power which should exalt himself, sitting in the place of God above all the heathen gods, and even oppose the God of gods by dispensing with his laws, and claim the prerogative of making new laws for his kingdom, and also Antichrist would prosper until the indignation be accomplished or judgment of the great day. That was William Miller, 1833. It was called Evidence from Scripture and History. Actually, the title was longer than that, but I didn't write it all down. Page 26. So you can search for that yourself. But anyway, William Miller's view of Daniel 11:36, actually 36 to 39, he comments on all of them. You can check it out yourself. As far as I can found, he never changed his view on that. That was William Miller's view until the day he died, as far as I know, that Daniel 11:36-39 applied to the papacy. There were some other pioneer Adventists who held that view as well. Joshua V. Himes, Joseph, I don't remember. What's that?
Bates.
Not Bates, no. It's Joshua Himes and... Well, James White was one. There were some others. Yeah, Litch, that's the one. Josiah Litch. I knew it was a J. Josiah Litch actually printed both views. And actually, I think that he's right, because one is a historical understanding of it, and one is a future, which Ellen White tells us is going to happen. There's a future application of those prophecies, specifically Daniel 11:36.
This is all in Daniel and Revelation?
The book Daniel and Revelation? No. This right here did not come in Daniel and Revelation. This is from William Miller. I'm encouraging you guys to read the book Daniel and Revelation if you've never read it. It is really amazing to read those prophecies, how minutely they were.
I have to read, copy, be done.
Oh, I see.
I haven't touched it.
The 1941 edition.
Yeah.
Actually, what happened in 1941, there was a new book of a new order published, and it took out the non-Trinitarian statements.
Yeah.
The book Daniel and Revelation in its original and many of the later copies actually was very non-Trinitarian. It was so much so that later when the church became Trinitarian, they wanted to destroy that or that part of it, that to cover that up. So they got rid of those statements in Daniel and Revelation. Yes?
We were in the book and have Bible House down in Collegedale just recently, and they're reprinting the 1897.
Oh, wow, that's nice. I'd like to see that one. What he said for those listening on tape is he went to an ABC and they are reprinting the 1897 edition of Daniel and Revelation, which of course will have those non-Trinitarian statements. Now, I want to look at some statements from a man by the name of Benjamin Cream. You may have never heard of this guy. Has anybody ever heard of him? Okay, there are a few people who heard of Benjamin Cream. Now, Benjamin Cream, he was a New Age prophet of the New Age movement. When I say was, I think he's still alive.
I think so. He's old.
Yeah, he's an old man, but he was a prophet. So what he says the New Age movement takes seriously. And Cream insists that a so-called second coming that is prophesied by many religions will come in the form of Maitreya. The New Age movement, they have a god called Maitreya. And that comes from Wikipedia Encyclopedia article Benjamin Cream, and it shows where that's online. It's easy to find. Now here's another statement. This is from their website, the official website of the ministry that Benjamin Cream instituted, which, let's see, that is, it's found on shareinternational.org. But check out this statement. The question is asked, could you explain the relationship between the disciple Jesus and the Christ? Benjamin Cream's answer, that's what BC stands for, the disciple Jesus, who is now the Master Jesus, was born in Palestine as a third degree initiate. He was and still is a disciple of the Christ and made the great sacrifice of giving up his body for the use of the Christ by the occult process of overshadowing. The Christ, Maitreya, took over and worked through the body of Jesus from the baptism onwards. That's pretty sad, pretty messed up. He continues, Jesus lives now in a Syrian body, which is some 600 years old. You know, they have some really weird views in the New Age movement. And has his base in Rome. He has, in the last 2,000 years, worked in the closest relation to the Christ, saving his time and energy where possible, and has special work to do with the Christian churches.
Wow.
He is one of the masters who will very shortly return to outer work, physical manifestation, in the world, taking over the throne of Saint Peter in Rome. He will seek to transform the Christian churches insofar as they are flexible enough to respond correctly to the new reality which the return of the Christ and the masters will create. That's a pretty heavy statement, isn't it? I want you to understand what's happening here. This is the prophet of the New Age movement, which is a prophet of Satan, really, because the New Age movement is the witches, the warlocks, pagans. It's a very satanic organization. And this is their prophet. And this is what he says. He's preparing, this is Satan behind all this, preparing his people. So this is going to be, you know, all of the pagan world is being prepared to receive somebody called Christ taking over the throne of Saint Peter in Rome. Can you see what's happening here? You know, at the end, there's going to be a unification. It's a big job to unify and get people to worship and come under the mark of the beast issue from all these religions that exist in the world. But can you see what Satan's doing already? He's preparing his people to accept this person to come as Christ, call himself Christ. See, that's what it says, is the return of the Christ. And the masters will create. It's really startling. Revelation 13, 8, the Bible says, and all that dwell upon the earth, how many?
All
that dwell upon the earth shall worship him whose names are not written in the book of life of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. Remember, Jesus said, rejoice that your name is written in the Lamb's book of life. That is what needs to happen. And of course, that's not going to happen if we don't have Christ in our heart. Okay, so all the world is going to worship this false Christ. You know, Christ is going. There's going to be a false Christ that comes, an impersonation of the return of Christ. Mm-hmm. It's going to be a fake one. Yeah. Satan is already paving the way for this to happen, and it's not only in the pagans. Watch. Who is Maitreya? This is also on the Share International. When asked, who is Maitreya? The Share International website answers, he has been expected for generations by all of the major religions. Christians know him as the Christ and expect his imminent return. Jews await him as the Messiah. Hindus look for the coming of Krishna, Buddhists expect him as Maitreya Buddha, and Muslims anticipate the Imam Mahdi or Messiah. Although the names are different, many believe that they all refer to the same individual, the world teacher whose personal name is Maitreya, pronounced Maitreya, preferring to be known simply as the teacher. Maitreya has not come as a religious leader or to found a new religion, but as a teacher and guide for people of every religion and those of no religion. Can you see prophecy being fulfilled here? There's going to be a unification of all of these religions of all the world. And it's he continues, at this time of great political, economic, and social crisis, Maitreya will inspire humanity to see itself as one family and create a civilization based on sharing economic and social justice and global cooperation. He will launch a call to action to save the millions of people who starve to death. Every year in a world of plenty, among Maitreya's recommendations will be a shift in social priorities so that adequate food, housing, clothing, education, and medical care become universal rights. Under Maitreya's inspiration, humanity itself will make the required changes and create a saner and more just world for all. That's from the Share International website. And keep in mind, this is Satan. He is planning for this false Christ to return and to do all this work, to unite all the religions and even the ones with no religions, the whole world. And it's going to be under the guise of helping humanity to be more good. Anyway, all the false religions are expecting this to happen. It's coming. Yes?
I couldn't help but put B in front of the betray.
What's that?
Betray.
No, okay, betray. Yes, it is a betrayal. Maitreya in Buddhism. Maitreya is a bodhisattva who Buddhists believe will eventually appear on earth, achieve complete enlightenment, and teach the pure Dharma. Maitreya is comparable to second coming prophecies in other religions, such as the coming of Kalki, the final avatar of Vishnu in Hinduism, the return of Jesus in Christianity, or of Saoshyant in Zoroastrianism. That's from the Encyclopedia Glossary on the article Maitreya. Anyway, this is startling, friends. Matthew 24, verse 3, Jesus warned us of this. Where there's a question, what shall be the sign of thy coming and of the end of the world? Jesus began his answer by saying, take heed that no man deceive you. Matthew 24, verse 4, that was his first statement. So why did he start with such a warning? He's expecting it to happen. He knows what's going to happen. He knows that Christ is going to be impersonated. The second coming of Christ is going to be impersonated. And that's why he says, be careful, take heed that no man deceive you. Then he goes on, verse 25 and 26, he explains, he says, behold, I have told you before. Wherefore, if they shall say unto you, behold, he is in the desert, go not forth. Behold, he is in the secret chambers, believe it not. You know how, you can imagine how worldwide this announcement is going to be that Christ has come.
Yeah.
If you're a Christian, Christ is here. If you're a Buddhist, whatever, I don't remember the names of them, but whatever religion you are, this guy is here to solve all your problems. Friends, it's going to happen. It's a false revival. Now, I would expect that very likely he's going to take, we already saw what Satan's preparing him is to take over the seat of Rome, the Pope in Rome. Now, it's very simple. Rome did it once when Constantine shifted his headquarters to Constantinople. He could shift his headquarters from Rome to what we just read in Daniel 11, verse 45, to Jerusalem. So anyway, the reason I'm sharing all of this with you is I'm trying to share with you the importance of studying for yourself and examine these things and be careful to watch what's happening. Watch Turkey. Watch what they do. Watch what's going on in the news. But also watch the papacy, because they're a fulfillment of this prophecy as well. 2 Corinthians 11:14 says, and no marvel, for Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light. That's what I believe is going to happen when this false Christ comes. You know who it is? Satan himself. It's probably the most significant work that he's planning to do on this world, at least at that time. Satan himself is going to be there. So why does it say, go not forth? You know, Satanism is becoming popular and becoming friendly, child-friendly and all of this. I don't know if you've seen any of this stuff, but anyway, it's all turning to this final event, preparing the world to receive a false Christ, to receive Satan, coming to solve all your problems, to make peace. Have you ever heard the idea that Christ is going to come and set up a 1,000 years peace on earth? Friends, that's not correct. He's not setting up his 1,000 years of peace on earth.
Amen.
Study that for yourself. Again, I'm encouraging you to study. Don't take my word for anything. Read the Bible for yourself. Study all the evidence because it's there.
Amen.
I do have more to share. So Revelation 15:2. It says, and I saw as it were a sea of glass mingled with fire, and them that had gotten the victory over the beast, and over his image, and over his mark, and over the number of his name, stand on the sea of glass, having the harps of God. Is it okay? Is it enough to have victory over the mark of the beast?
No.
What does it say here?
Over his image.
They're going to get the victory over the beast, over his image, over his mark, and over the number of his name.
Yes.
Don't get satisfied thinking, well, I've got it right. I've got the victory over the mark of the beast.
Yes. Definitely.
That's not enough, friends. There's more to it than that. You know that? We just read it. They're going to get the victory over all of them. And that's why it's important for us to understand Satan doesn't have to just get you on the mark of the beast. Satan can get you on any one of these things, right? It doesn't matter. And if you look at these things, I believe all the world falls under one of those situations. And therefore, even the non-Christians can fall under it. The pagans, the other religions. But let's look at a few more verses. Revelation 17:3-4 says, so he carried me away. I just want to focus on where it says the number of his name. Just get a little more information on what that is, possibly. This is an understanding that might apply. Revelation 17:3-4, it says, so he carried me away in the spirit into the wilderness, and I saw a woman sit upon a scarlet-colored beast, full of names of blasphemy. You ever hear that word in the Bible before? Mostly referring to the man of sin or the papacy. I saw a woman sit upon a scarlet-colored beast full of names of blasphemy and having 7 heads and 10 horns. And the woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet color and decked with gold and precious stones and pearls, having a golden cup in her hand full of abominations and filthiness of her fornication. And upon her forehead, verse 5, upon her forehead was a name written. What name? Mystery, Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots and abominations of the earth. Notice what is the beginning of her name?
Mystery.
Mystery. Now who is this referring to again?
Babylon.
The papacy. What is the biggest mystery of?
Trinity.
The Trinity. Now you guys got that just like that. It's really easy, right?
What did they say?
Look, the Trinity is the greatest mystery of the papacy. And remember, this is associated with the name written on her forehead, is this mystery. The very first part is the Trinity. I'm sorry, is the very first part of her identification is the mystery of the Trinity, which, look at the central doctrine of Catholic faith. The mystery of the Trinity is the central doctrine of the Catholic faith. Upon it are based all the other teachings of the Church. The Church studied this mystery with great care, and after 4 centuries of clarification, took us 4 centuries. Now that's talking about 4 centuries from when Christ was here.
That's right.
Or from when the Bible was written.
Right.
Took us 4 centuries of clarification. We decided to state the doctrine in this way. In the unity of the Godhead, there are 3 persons, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. That comes from the Handbook for Today's Catholic, page 11 in my copy. Some copies it's page 16 or page 19. But anyway, that's the central doctrine. The mystery of the Trinity is the central doctrine of Catholic faith. Upon it are based all the other teachings of the Church. So you can understand why in Revelation 17, when it says, upon her name was written, the first thing is mystery. And I would really encourage you to consider that the mystery is connected to the name of the papacy we have to have the victory over the mark of the beast, but also the number of his name. And I think this can apply quite well to the Trinity doctrine, which is their central doctrine. I think we're on a roll of being overtime today. Revelation 14:11, and the smoke of their torment ascendeth up forever and ever, and they have no rest day or night, who worship the beast and his image, and whosoever receives the mark of his name.
Yeah.
I just want to encourage you guys, don't rest assured, well, I'm not going to get the mark of the beast because I keep the Sabbath. Yeah. Well, that's good, but before you start patting yourself on the back like the people who believe there's one God, you do well, but the devils also believe. There's more to it than that, friends. It all revolves around worship, and the central doctrine of the Catholic faith is the Trinity. I believe the Trinity is also, you can't worship God on the right day and worship the wrong God. Doesn't do any good.
No.
Daniel 11:32, such as do wickedly against the covenant shall he corrupt by flatteries, but the people that do know their God shall be strong and do exploits. This applies to our time as well. Right? I do have a lot more here, but I'm not going to share it all. If you want, you can get the notes. I can rush through them really quick if you want to quickly see them. Revelation 12:17, the dragon was wroth, went to make war with the remnant of her seed to keep the commandments of God and the testimony of Jesus. Revelation 14:1, I looked and lo, the Lamb stood, 144,000 with him, with the Father's name written in the forehead. In contrast to this woman beast who has a name written in her forehead, that's the wrong one. It's not the Father's name, it's that one that you just described, where there's Satan involved in that. Revelation 14, these are they which are not defiled with women, verses 4 and 5, for they are virgins. They follow the Lamb whithersoever he goeth. And in their mouth is found no guile. You know what that word is? Deceit. No trickery. There's no lies. In fact, in Zephaniah 3, is it 11 or 14? It says, the remnant of Israel shall not do iniquity nor speak lies, neither shall a deceitful tongue be found in their mouth. Revelation 14:12, here's the patience of the saints. Here are they that keep the commandments of God and have the faith of Jesus. That's very important. Yep. The faith of Jesus is not the faith of Lynnford or the faith of somebody else. It's the faith of Jesus. It's his faith. And he had faith, great faith. And that's what we need because our faith isn't enough. Faith, the fruit of the Spirit is faith. Part of the fruit of the Spirit is faith. And it's not your faith that you get. It's his faith, Christ's faith. Because your sons, God has sent forth the Spirit of his Son, along with his faith, into your heart, crying, Abba, Father. And this is a record that God has given to us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. He who hath the Son has life. He who hath not the Son of God has not life. All of what we looked at is a waste of time without the Son of God in your heart. Right? And if we are being critical and unkind and mean to each other, that's a pretty good sign that there's something missing. Right? Be honest. Because we're supposed to love even our enemies. By this shall all men know that you're my disciples, if you have love one to another. That is the end.
Amen.
All right, let's go ahead and close with a word of prayer. Our dear Father in heaven, we are so thankful for you doing everything that pertains to our salvation by sending your Son to die for our sins and to live in us. Everything is available to us, Lord, and we just have to receive and accept what you have given and then walk, deny ourselves, take up the cross, and follow Christ. Lord, I pray that that reality would be true for each one of us. Everyone hearing my voice, whether it's on not in this room or in this room, Lord, I just pray for complete conversion so that our attitudes will be right, will be seasoned with the love of God coming through everything, that we can speak the truth in love and that we can be kind and tender-hearted to one another. And so I pray that you just subdue all of the wickedness that may be in our hearts, that it just be completely removed, and that you give us a new heart and a new spirit. So I just commit myself and all of these brethren to you, Lord, and I trust that you'll keep us. And Lord, we know that there's a lot of difficult times coming ahead, and we just pray that we would be ready that we would be strong. And we know that that only comes through knowing you. That alone is not going to come through studying prophecies and knowing all of everything. If we don't have the love of God in our hearts, it's a waste of time. So I just pray that this reality would be true for each of us, and that your love would shine through even the rest of this camp meeting, that people will know and recognize that we've been with Christ. So I thank you and praise you for what you're doing and what you will do in us. In Jesus' name, amen.